We define the specific heat of a substance as the amount of heat necessary to bring 1 kilogram of that substance up by 1 degree Celsius. Different substances will require a different amount of heat to bring their temperature up by 1 degree. For example, we need 4.184 joules to bring water from 20 to 21 degrees Celsius, but only 2.386 joules to bring honey from 20 to 21. Of course, for gases, depending on the system we're adding the heat to, the amount of heat required to bring up the temperature by 1 degree Celsius can differ. If we have a kilogram of argon inside a rigid tank, and we add heat until the temperature rises by 1 degree Celsius, we would measure 0.3122 kilojoules. This means that under our definition of specific heat, for a constant volume process like this inside a rigid tank, the specific heat of argon is 0.3122 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin, or Celsius. However, if we now have 1 kilogram of argon in a piston cylinder system, and we add heat to bring its temperature up by 1 degree Celsius, would we need the same amount of heat? Would this value be different? Would it be more heat or less heat required to raise its temperature? Well, we already know that in a constant pressure system like this, part of the heat we add will go towards the work generated by the expansion of the gas. Only part of the heat we add will actually go into increasing the temperature of the gas. Therefore, we would expect this heat value to have to be more than that required to increase the temperature inside a rigid tank. And in fact, it is. In the piston cylinder system, we need 0.523 kilojoules to make it go up by 1 degree Celsius. This means that for a constant pressure process, the specific heat is 0.523 kilojoules per kilogram Kelvin. In other words, for any substance, we will be able to look up or calculate the specific heat at constant volume, CV, and the specific heat at constant pressure, CP. That's lowercase c, sub v, and sub p. And this distinction makes sense. We know that for a change of temperature of a substance, we would be looking at the difference of specific internal energy for a constant volume process, like this rigid tank, and we would be looking at the difference of specific enthalpy for a constant pressure process, like the piston cylinder system. Remember that enthalpy is equal to internal energy plus P times V. And a quick parenthesis here. Lowercase c is called specific heat, and lowercase c times the mass is capital C, and we call it heat capacity. This applies to both CV and CP. The differential form of the first law of thermodynamics, or energy conservation equation, is dU equal to delta Q minus delta W, or delta Q minus P dV. This is the same as saying delta Q is equal to dU plus P dV, or even just dH for the case of constant pressure systems. Notice that we use the delta letter for changes in values that depend on the path of the process, and just the letter d for changes in values that do not depend on the path of the process. dU is always U2 minus U1, regardless of the path of the process, just like dH is H2 minus H1. The heat, on the other hand, does depend on the path we take from state 1 to state 2, and therefore we use the delta instead of d. For constant volume processes, we know that dV is 0. Therefore, delta Q is equal to dU. From the very definition of CV, the infinitesimal change in energy dQ is gonna be equal to CV times an infinitesimal change in temperature dT. Therefore, dU is equal to CV dT. With the exact same reasoning, for a constant pressure process, dH will be equal to CP dT. The first one of these tells us that the change in internal energy is dependent on the change in temperature. But what about just the internal energy, not the change, at any given state? Is U a function of pressure and volume besides just the temperature? Well, it turns out that the internal energy of an ideal gas is independent of volume and pressure. It is only a function of T. When we get to understanding entropy S, we will be able to prove this mathematically. But even at the time when this statement was first postulated, it was an empirical conclusion based on scientific experiments. In brief, the main experiment that supported this idea was performed by Gay-Lussac. Two containers, perfectly insulated, meaning no heat transfer, were connected by an insulating membrane. One contained gas, the other one nothing, pure vacuum. When the membrane is removed and the gas in one expands into the vacuum in two, the pressure and volume change. Since no work was added or taken from the system, and since no temperature changes were observed, meaning that there was no heat exchanged with the surrounding, the internal energy of the gas remained the same, despite changes of pressure and volume. This means that the internal energy of an ideal gas is only a function of its temperature. And again, we'll prove this mathematically later with the help of entropy. Worth pointing out here is that the internal energy of non-ideal gases is not a function of temperature only, and that similar experiments were later carried out by Joule, showing that for non-ideal gases, the internal energy was not a function of temperature only. So the internal energy U is a function of T only. What about entropy H? Well, since H is defined as U plus PV, link below to that 12-minute lecture, and PV equals RT for ideal gases, H equals to U plus RT. Since R is just a constant and U is already a function of T only, then H is also a function of T only. These two expressions are very useful because this is how we're able to find the change in total internal energy or the change in total enthalpy delta U and delta H by integrating. Delta U is U2 minus U1, which is also the integral from T1 to T2 of CV dt, and delta H is H2 minus H1, which is the integral from T1 to T2 of CP dt. And this is true in terms of total or specific properties. Now, the second very important concept here today is that the specific heat values for some substances are not constant. For example, bringing water vapor from 150 to 151 degrees Celsius requires a different amount of energy than bringing it up from 250 to 251. For some gases like argon, the two heat capacity values are constant. It doesn't matter if we're bringing argon from 1000 to 1001 Celsius, or from 2000 to 2001 degrees Celsius, or any other 1 degree change. Some of the other common gases that have constant specific heat at constant pressure, like argon, are helium, neon, krypton, xenon, and radon. However, for some gases, both CV and CP are indeed a function of temperature. For example, hydrogen, oxygen, water, air, and carbon dioxide. For some of these, and for some of the regions only, we can assume that the specific heat is constant, or also that the specific heat relation to temperature is linear, and therefore we can use an average specific heat, but more on that later. Of course, a diagram like this will not offer enough precision for us to find the specific heat for a given temperature. We would be almost guessing it by eyeballing it with almost no accuracy. And that's why we have two alternatives for finding specific heats. The first one, we have a table with the ideal gas specific heats of various common gases for different temperatures. And the second one, if you need the specific heat for constant pressure for a temperature that you don't see there, you have tables for the coefficients of a third degree polynomial fit so that you can calculate CP bar for any given temperature. You substitute the A, B, C, and D coefficients for a specific substance, and you get an expression for CP bar in terms of T. You then plug in your temperature and find the molar specific heat for constant pressure. Quick parenthesis here, remember that the bar on top of any property is the molar specific value. So if you want CP, you can find it by dividing CP bar by molar mass. Regardless of the method, finding CP is obviously extremely helpful, because if we want to calculate the enthalpy change between two states, for example, which we defined earlier as an integral, we would be integrating this expression with respect to T and evaluating it at T1 and T2. Pretty straightforward. And even though this table only has CP, not CV, we'll later learn how to get to CV from CP. Just know that if you have one, we can find the other. So, like I said, this integration process is pretty straightforward. However, thermodynamics tables go one step further. It turns out we actually have tables that have already calculated these values for some gases, for example, air. If we wanted to know the enthalpy change between 240 to 270 degrees Celsius, we would write down H for 270 and subtract H for 240, skipping the integration altogether. Now, why does this work? What does H equal to 240.02 kilojoules per kilogram mean? Because what we stated at the beginning of this lecture was that the specific heat is defined as an amount of heat required to cause a change in temperature, and it therefore needs to be multiplied by a change of temperature, not just a temperature value. So if H equal to 240O2 was obtained by multiplying Cp times T, what does that mean? The answer to that question is that the values we see are really the enthalpy change from a reference temperature to the temperature we're interested in, and we don't even need to know what that reference temperature is. If we're looking for the change in enthalpy between 240 and 270, we're really finding the area under the curve for Cp versus T. And that's why if we have the 240.02 value, which means the area under the curve from the reference temperature up to 240 degrees Celsius, and the 270.11 value, which means the area under the curve from the same reference temperature up to 270 degrees Celsius, we can just subtract them to find the area that we're interested in. So to sum up, if we want to find the enthalpy change for any substance between any two temperatures, we have three options. Well, technically four. From most accurate to least accurate, find the table that has the enthalpy changes from a random reference temperature to find the enthalpy change as the difference between enthalpies. 2. Find the polynomial coefficients and carry out the integral. 3. Look at a table that gives us Cp for those temperatures and assume that the change is small enough for it to be linear so that we can take an average and multiply it by the change in temperature. Or finally, 4. Find Cp at the initial temperature and assume that Cp is independent of temperature and therefore constant. Of course, this last one can only be assumed in very specific scenarios, and it can still be very inaccurate. Now, the third and last quick concept is about specific heats. Cp is defined as the amount of heat needed to add 1 degree Celsius to a substance in a constant pressure system, which by definition is equal to the change in enthalpy. But even if a process does not occur at constant pressure, you can still use Cp to calculate the change in enthalpy of an ideal gas. The change in enthalpy only will probably not suffice in that scenario, so you might need to calculate more than just that, but remember that for an ideal gas, the specific heats are only function of temperature, not pressure. So both the enthalpy and internal energy will and can be calculated with Cp and Cv respectively, regardless of if the system is constant volume or constant pressure. If you want to see some examples on this topic, make sure to check out the links in the description of this video. You'll find the other examples on this topic, as well as the other lectures of the Thermo course, and even playlists of other engineering courses like Statics, Mechanics of Materials, Machine Design, and SolidWorks. Thanks for watching!